I think it has something to do with my original interest as a kid in Hellenistic sculpture, surfacing more and more and more. I mean, that's the stuff I always loved. And of course, if you were making art in the 70s, you know, if you began, or if you even began making art in the 60s, there was not very much to encourage the idea of Baroque narrative or Hellenistic narrative.
I met Jonathan Silver in about 1967 or 1968, and he was just at the beginning of working on Heads then. As my friendship with him evolved through the 70s, I sort of lived through these particular works. In the mid to late 80s, he became known primarily for very expressive three-dimensional figures.
When you work in this fashion, in a fashion which really ultimately derives from abstract expressionism or cubism, you work with components, and in the course of making the work, the image resolves itself. So you arrive at a certain point when that's that, when you feel the components are in balance. It's an improvisatory way of working which arrives at its own conclusion. When you get into that idea of collage and embedded in things, everything seems to you full of possibility. You're completely at the mercy of anything you see in the street.
There'd be 50 pieces laying there in the box of little bits of metal and crumpled up things and little pieces of plaster and all that. And he's looking at the sculpture and he's got in mind something. He looks in the box and he's looking around the box and, you know, holds something up there and puts it down, holds up another one, puts it there. We go have lunch. And then we get up at the end of lunch, and he goes, okay. And then he goes back to the box, and he picks up a piece, and he glues it on.
From the mid-80s on, I worked with him in the studio doing casting work and then helping him set up his installations. And I always was absolutely fascinated with this series of works, which was piled up on the shelves in the studio and was never really seen.
I remember his studio, it was so many molds, plasters, before they're broken up or used to make molds from, and plenty of bronzes. In some cases, the plasters were finished pieces, and in other cases, he hadn't yet cast.
I remember multiple times going over to his studio, and it was just like an absolute mess. The floor was just filled with plaster, cigarettes, and coffee mugs, and all sorts of random things around. I thought it was kind of cool, and I would just kind of come over and I'd find him, like, on his couch with a Mets hat on, watching the Mets game, in, like, the midst of all this insanity.
Now, when did you move into this?
1972, mm-hmm. I think.
So that practically all your sculpture has been made
has
here?
Has been made here,
right here.
Yeah. Right here.
It's sort of strange, the idea to me. You can sort of start with drawings and then you really start with heads. The head sort of splits apart and it becomes fragmented and it turns against itself and moves in different directions. And then from the head, the figures, the full-length body, grew up, and then the body sort of grew up more and more in the round. And then from that, you wind up with complex installations. But it all sort of came out of the head.
Somewhere along the line, I began to get very distinct flashes of subject matter, you know, where I knew what I wanted the piece to look like from the beginning and worked towards that. It's like you get a sort of flash in a moment of that's what I want that to be. This is that pregnant woman, or it's this kind of hallucinatory vision, or this kind of drama. Whatever it is, you know that's what you want it to be, and you work towards it.
I was very close with Michael Brentson, who was also sympathetic with the program that I was putting together at Grunebaum, which was mostly first and second generation abstract expressionists. And at one point, I mentioned to Michael I was looking for some younger artists, and I thought getting some mid-career artists would be good. And then he mentioned that he had a friend who was a wonderful sculptor, Jonathan Silver, and that I should go look at his work. It made total sense to show somebody who was breaking new ground and yet working in a classical tradition, not unlike abstract expressionists, who we all know, the first and second generation, all of them were capable of figurative drawing, and they evolved into abstract artists. Jonathan had digested, as well as anyone I knew, all the mythology and the history of bronze, and then would come up with creations that really were a kind of self-portraiture, and yet there was a thread between that, the art historical periods that preceded him, and then also his own psychological world, which was extremely complex and to him quite disturbing, and he allowed that to take a role in the work itself.
I had gotten my master's and then was admitted to the PhD program at Columbia and began working with Meyer Shapiro on Giacometti's painting. Was going to be the subject of my dissertation. I remember when I came down to Greensboro, Bert gave me a big lecture about being sure to get my PhD because he hadn't gotten his and blah, blah, blah.
He was working on his doctorate when I met him.
Yeah, in art history.
And he was writing it on Giacometti. And I typed up his paper. I kept typing and retyping and retyping and retyping, and he just stopped doing it.
I mean, at that point in my life, I was someone who was consistently resentful of opportunities. But I did learn a little better, or at least I learned to conceal my resentment of opportunities. So then I went down, Bert hired me, and I went down to Greensboro, and it's 1966.
The art history Jonathan taught always seemed to be a completely different history from the one they read in the book.
Usually was. It was completely improvised.
It was
totally idiosyncratic. I did do a couple little pieces of sculpture in Greensboro, a little ahead of myself, but I still considered myself an art historian. I was giving a lecture and I was showing Autumn Rhythm to a class. And I hadn't shown it to a class for a very long time. And I think the last time I'd shown it, I still was giving that interpretation of the fact that he was this painting full of organic suggestiveness, and yet there were no obvious figurative references and blah, blah, blah. And I put the thing up on the screen and it was just thronged with faces and heads. And I thought, Jesus, you know? You mean I was so under the impression of this taboo against their not being there that I didn't see them, you know? I mean, it was like that whole system of thought read out of our experience, our direct experience. Fortunately, abstract expressionism is a lot better than its formalist interpretation, you know? And if it were that rigid and narrow and empty as Clement Greenberg would have it, that somehow abstraction represented the last logical final step in an evolution from the Renaissance until the present, and now art had achieved a universality, right? Mm-hmm. A non-culture-bound universality. Mm-hmm. And of course, the political content of that is rarely discussed. The idea that these are forms which transcended a particular cultures and particularly Western culture and addressed itself universally. The form was the essence when you peeled off the culture-bound layer of representation, you had underneath it that was Mondrian's idea, pure form, which was universal.
So you sort of cleared the way kind of theoretically before you got into the sculpture?
Well, no, I don't think that was it. I think that, I mean, in terms of my, is this going to bother you?
We're all over here.
You're all cool. And I'm the guy who's smoking, right?
If it doesn't bother you.
It doesn't, yeah. Right. I guess that's one way to put it. No, it was never theoretical. I wasn't clearing the ground theoretically. What I was doing was looking very hard at things in terms of the art history. Now, I accepted formalism on a certain level. And I think that probably it wasn't until the 80s that I really, that my own impulses just carried me in a direction which obviously made that meaningless to me. I never really worked that stuff out in my head. I mean, or if I did, it was an unconscious process.
At Columbia, he met Peter Agostini, who was teaching sculpture there.
And that's when he decided in that sculpture class that he was going to actually make sculpture and not be an art historian.
When Bert hired me, he hired me along with and as an adjunct to hiring Peter Agostini to teach sculpture and Bruce Gagnier. And we drew. We got a model every night and just drew constantly.
Yeah, we had a very heavy drawing thing going at a time when everybody else was abandoning.
The issue of three-dimensionality was very important to him in a way that I think is probably different from most sculptors, because his natural tendency was to deal with an image from the front rather than to deal with it from all sides.
Jonathan's work evolved. It evolved around the back from the frontal. And some of these sculptures, some of these more abstract sculptures, still have a singular best viewpoint.
Jonathan was so excited. Remember when he found that surgical saw?
Uh-huh. So you could cut plaster. Any shape, any kind of curve. This is just like a wire thing. You can wrap it around something and cut the back of something with it. You know, you can cut inside. You can swerve around and cut any kind of contour you want.
First, it looks like clay here that he's made a casting of, that he's cast a plaster. And I would say it's gone into the plaster then and planed with a sure form or something like that. I could kind of file our sure form and gotten these planes off of the clay surface.
So he's breaking up his form in a way that is responding to cubism. And he's interested in using the vertical line as a means to make one side play against another, and he's also trying to open up the form. The principle is to make substance respond to space and light. He wants to introduce energy into his forms. And Jonathan is dealing with this as not an intellectual exercise. He's dealing with this also in a very emotional way, and he wants the content to come through. And I see these very much as portraits of himself.
You know, once you've got a central division and something that's conceived as an aperture beginning from the central division, you have that combination of phallic and vaginal, you know, you have a sexual metaphor there. And I know for a fact that, when I say I know for a fact, I'm thinking about a variety of events in my life that I am not going to recount relative to the making of some of these hits. You know, there's all kinds of anxieties and stuff that are being resolved in restructuring this phallic element in relationship to the central division. And
I have experience of psychoanalytic therapy and a background in that, which is not going to keep those thoughts too far from me.
I told him at the show that, you know, at the exhibit, that this stuff is really interesting, but I just don't understand it. And he said, "What do you mean you don't understand it? It's sexual frustration. It's just like heavy metal." And I will never forget that he said that, because he, you know, it was scary. I was like 17 at the time, and, you know, I was like, okay, you're right.
Well, he learned what he learned from his analyst. Jonathan never went to high school.
He didn't tolerate high school.
And no, he couldn't. And he refused to go. And his mother hired a psychiatrist for him and sent him to the psychiatrist every day.
He was in analysis for over 25 years. And I think that, like a lot of things that are delved into in that process, that you go back and revisit and try and sort out, I think a lot of that also affected his sculpture and fit in with his sense of antiquity and fragmentation.
Among the first things I remember that really impressed me were things like the head against the wall.
Yeah, that was in the late 70s. And when did I have that show in Greensboro? In 78, I think.
78, yeah.
With Chris Cairns.
He worked collaboratively with Christopher Cairns, who, for a number of years. And they did a lot of the early heads that have the inset pieces of plaster, and showed together several times down at Haverford.
They were very close, and I think Jonathan was quick to admit that Chris had provided insights that helped him with his work, and vice versa.
Why did you stop the heads? When you turn to the figures, the heads?
Well, I didn't entirely. As a matter of fact, all the figures began with heads. The heads were done first. At a certain point, I began to make the necks in such a way that they began to suggest feet. As part of a solution of how do you do a head if you're not doing a bust? Where do you cut it?
From what you're saying, the body is really implied within the head.
Because the expression of the face is going to determine the gesture of the limbs.
You mean literally with a figure like this, that you literally modeled the head and then you started to model
the body? The head is modeled and cast, so that I take a plaster head and set it up on the armature, and then really model from there.
Who cast the mother piece?
Me.
You, in bronze?
Yes.
That was one of his early figures.
83, that's the one that I cast. It had his head on it. That's his face.
Could be his mother's
look
face,
at
too.
It, yeah.
If someone once asked me, there was a big sculpture that I did, it had some of the same character, and I did it shortly after my mother died, and they said to me, why was it 7 feet? And without even thinking about it, I answered, because that was the physical relationship I had to my mother when I was 5 years old. She was a very extraordinary woman in a lot of ways, very troubled, and if you think that I have a slightly dark cast to my view of life, I come by it honestly. She was, in the Jewish sense, the aristocrat of the family. She came from a long line of big shots. Her father, Gedaliah Bublik, was a big shot editor of Jewish newspapers in New York. So she came from a real literary background. On her mother's side, she was descended from Elijah of Vilna, the Vilna Gaon, in the 18th century.
You know, it wasn't the warmest environment, which probably contributed to Jonathan's art tremendously. You know, his father was another guy that was extremely involved in his own career.
My grandfather, Edward S. Silver, was the judge in the actual French Connection. It was a large heroin ring in the late 50s.
His father I met twice. His father didn't approve of me. But his mother did.
Did dad, was there any reason why?
Because I'm not Jewish.
As a kid, I was always very interested in that period
when Christianity and Rome and Greece and all came together. I remember sitting with my brother-in-law, who's an Orthodox rabbi, sometime in the 60s, when a famous head of Titus was unearthed in Israel. And of course, it was a front page story on the Times. And the only thing he said was, he looked at it and says, "Titus, that bastard." Because Titus was the Roman emperor who had destroyed the Second Temple. And for him, it was a contemporary disaster.
I think Jonathan was not really religious. As an artist, he felt like it was all fair territory. I think he was using all of this history and choosing from it what he wanted.
Frequently, there are real combinations of real personal archaeology, because there are elements of sculpture that are 10, 15 years apart, put together in a single piece. Like that head was made in 1970, and this piece was made in 1985, so.
He began modeling a head of a student of his. That head, which he used on a number of pieces.
And that's really quite an early portrait head, one of the first ever made, maybe from 1971. And I had it as an independent head. And then I was working a figurative piece up from the base. And when I got to about the middle, I had the idea of just putting that head up at that angle on the top. I had a classical subject in mind. And when I saw the piece finished, I realized that the model from whom I had worked was very much on my mind. She had been crippled by polio early in life. And the contrast between the erect and bold head and the malformed lower section seemed to me a portrait of her indomitable spirit.
In 82, I went to Rome and Florence, and then I got an idea that sculpture was capable of drama on the level of epic poetry.
Who did you look at there?
Well, I looked at the Medici Chapel. It was what blew my mind.
So when you walk into the Medici Chapel, whammo, you've got nothing but Michelangelo's intention for how you should perceive that work and feel it. Once I began to do figures and environments, it became easier to do whole figures, which could then derive subsequent layers of meaning or intrusions from the environment.
The definition of installation really grew up in the 1960s, and what it meant was an environment in which people could move and an artwork in which they could participate. It means treating pieces as characters in a tableau. In other words, pieces grouped differently to make what I would really like to call sculptural opera.
So you would want the visitor to feel some kind of real identification?
Absolutely. And in a certain way, I would like them to forget they're looking at sculpture altogether and become fully engaged in the subject as they would if they were reading a book or in a theater.
He had this idea. It was extremely ambitious that we hid with a curtain.
And you came in through this curtain. And so the whole thing was controlled. There was no light from the outside.
Alexander Severus was a Roman emperor of the 3rd century who was reputed to have had a special chapel in which he included not only old Roman gods and emperors, but also significant figures in Western and Jewish tradition. No one knows what it looks like, and it was a wonderful opportunity to reimagine the thing.
It was just as much as a collage head where he takes something and puts it here and there. He was doing that historically in a more epic way in the chapel.
It was almost like seeing a train wreck, and you wanted to look a little closer and see the gory details. I felt as though I was experiencing something that was cinematic and dramatic and timeless.
He wanted it to be a real experience. The smell of the roses would be fresh, plus the dustiness of the sarcophagus itself. You know, the clay, it was like raw clay, wasn't it?
I think it was everything from rubber mold to plaster.
And there was clay, no?
And clay.
The figure on the left is Abraham, where I had a big head and then stuffed twigs under the head to make something that was reminiscent of the altar at which Isaac was sacrificed. This is Apollonius of Tyana, a wizard and a prophet of the time of Nero in the first century AD. There is a figure of Jesus in the background. The figure on the right is Orpheus and Eurydice. Orpheus is conceived of as blind and almost unable to guide himself. And the figure who leads, who inspires, who also seems to restrain and inhibit at the same time as the figure of Eurydice, which no doubt has something to do with my sense of the complex relationship between male artists and women who inspire and impede and distract him. The condition of his leading her out of Hades is that he doesn't look back, but she says, "You don't love me, otherwise you'd look." And he looks.
The emotional content really starts to come forward when he makes that decision to project himself into the gallery space with his work. And I think that there really is a before and after, and you can date it. That was this big leap he made to this very operatic, Hellenistic tableau.
I don't know if you spoke to Marion, who was wonderful. And a fine sculptor in her own right, and also was totally devoted to Jonathan and helping him. At this point in his life, you know, he had already had some physical setbacks, enough so that he couldn't do this work alone.
Before I did it, I could see. Now I don't see so well as I did before. Things are getting dark.
When life deflates, And that's why so many, I think, elements of the work showed that, you know, the fragility of life and what really happens. You know, it's life and decay.
There was a little book I had called The Children's History of Israel, and I read over and over and over and over again those descriptions of the Maccabees and their relationship to the Greeks. And somehow it became all engaged in my mind with my personal struggle with Orthodox Judaism, you know, my need to be free of it. Jews have a word for someone who is an apostate. The term for an apostate is apikoros, which means Epicurean. That is to say, the very definition of a Jew who reads himself out of Judaism is a Greek. And somehow it came together in my mind with my love of the special pathos of Hellenistic sculpture, which was important to me. And I think it was just very deeply rooted in the psychology of my whole childhood, and then became engaged with my family relations and everything else. Those things are not separate, you know, they're part of moments of experience of where historical epochs, if they're felt deeply enough, become analogous to personal epochs in your life. That's a head I made based on my wife. She had an aneurysm from which she almost died.
I think in those heads of Barbara, he was dealing with a person close to him, and he was dealing with a totality of that person as he experienced it at that moment.
Well, they were just two heads of me, I think, and they were slightly different, not much different. We had just gotten back from Minnesota, where they had installed this piece of his in the garden. And we came back, and then I came up here, and I passed out, and he found me and took me to St. Vincent's. He just kept after me until I was back and well. But he had this show coming up, and that's why he made them. And it was the one I made the curtains for when I got out of the hospital.
I was certainly after drama. That's, I've become increasingly interested in that aspect of it.
The lower room was theater, but very much filtered through a Freudian sensibility. We met at the gallery and sat in the installation and walked through it. And I think we talked for 2 hours or so about the installation with wonderful tangents about classical art or religion, his mother. It was really a wonderful interview.
It's a big space. It's about 50 feet deep and about 30 feet wide. The figure on the left is about 12 feet high, and the figure right above the circle of light is about 10 or 11 feet high.
I think the lower room was a kind of purgatory. Not quite hell, not quite heaven, that sort of indeterminate, intermediary space.
The narrative of this piece involved a woman reclining on this couch, dreaming she was at the point of death. She imagines herself standing amidst other figures which represent youth, sexuality, the idea of sacrifice through suffering.
After I had worked on it, I realized there's a famous Hellenistic sculpture of a fisherman looking up fearfully at the weather, which must have been the ultimate model for this.
That was really the only life-size figure as opposed to the 11 or 12-foot figure. And for me, she was the most compelling figure because you encountered her in your scale and in your terms. I think it's two things. One is these phantasms, perhaps of death or the next world, but they're also the phantasms of her memory.
The idea was that that critical moment, the sort of gray paint was descending on the walls and the mud was oozing into the room. It was sort of like a personally apocalyptic moment, yeah.
We made such a mess, yeah, on the walls, and then like a lot of clay, which we did textures on clumps all over the floor, and it was a lot of work. It was very physical.
Installations were very different kind of work for him. Like Rodin took a bunch of pieces and put them on the gates of hell, making one big piece. So the installations were one big piece made from many smaller pieces with this element that tied them all together. And sometimes that element was an element of decay. The lower room had the beautiful clay, the wet clay, that as the exhibition went on, the installation was there and the clay dried and the clay cracked and the clay crumbled, which was very appropriate. It was the lower room. Jesus Christ was upstairs in the upper room telling his disciples that he was going to die, that he was going to be betrayed, and that essentially death was nearby. And in the lower room, there's Charon taking over the river Styx. So we were in hell when we were in the lower room, or on our way nearby.
The oar was from a big figure of Charon, who was the ferry boatman of the river Styx. That was a 12-foot piece.
In the pagan point of view, hell or Hades is not necessarily the location of people who have not been saved. It's where everybody goes.
Yeah, I put that snake in the Sculpture Center exhibit. It went near a silvery, sexy human figure. It was a compliment to that figure. It was intended to be sort of a male, phallic snake demon.
Well, she's silver. That's not unintentional, given Jonathan's last name. I think she represents his mother, but in another way, because of the serpent, she may also evoke Eve, who was the original mother. And so she becomes an extremely psychologically charged character.
She's all the women who have partaken of that mythical quality that my mother had for me.
What's interesting about the Narcissus figure, which is also called Allegory of Love, was that he was looking at sexuality in all its, again, this word, complexity.
There's a certain kind of sexuality which is narcissistic, whether it's homosexual or heterosexual. Right. You know, sexuality is a phenomenon independent of gender, and the gender is really the casing in which an infinite variety of sexual shapes express themselves.
In 1990, the exhibition, The Expressionist Surface, Contemporary Art and Plaster, opened at the Queen's Museum of Art. It featured a number of artists, including Manuel Neri, George Siegel, Christopher Cairns, Peter Agostini, and Jonathan, site-specific installations. And the theme of Jonathan's work was a subway in New York City, in which somebody was thrown from the platform onto the tracks. He really cracked things up. He would break things. Whatever worked to elicit the emotion that he was after, he would do. There was also a beautiful, classically modeled woman who was looking in a mirror. It brought the viewer, who might have peered over her shoulder, into the piece through the reflection in the mirror. This work comes from a painterly tradition of Peter Paul Rubens and countless artists who depicted women looking at the mirror. She's the only figure that's intact. She is the muse. There's so much tragedy and angst in the work. I think that this dichotomy between the horror, but then the sublime beauty, you know, is found in her.
Gretchen was Faust's jilted lover, who was pregnant and who drowns her child and subsequently dies for it.
Was the degree of identification with the Gretchen figure greater than with previous figures that you've done?
Well, since it's my most recent big piece, that's a tough one to answer.
And almost feel like you're inside the belly.
There's a visceral identification with that piece that you're probably right, that I yeah. probably hadn't felt before. And comfortable with the idea.
Well, he started making heads in 1970 or 1971, and he died in 1992.
One of the things you do discover when you address mortality from this proximity is you do wake up to the fact that mortality is the run of human experience, the inevitable. It all of a sudden seems startling to you that people treat it as such an exception when it's everybody's inevitable destiny. And we persist in treating it as something extremely unusual and remarkable in every case where it occurs, which is every case.
But nobody wants to think that.
Yeah, but in a way, it makes it easier if you're thinking that that's a fair likelihood. You know, you suddenly recognize that, as Hamlet says, if it be not now, it is to come, you know. If it is to come, it be not now. The readiness is all. So you can compose yourself a little to that idea, he says. Maybe that's whistling in the dark. If I ever get out of this damn thing, I'm going to make nothing but joyous, upbeat,
the rest of my life will be devoted to my version of the dance.